Thank you all for coming to our public forum for March 10, 2015. Tony, who is our public information officer, will give the read the rules for public forum.
Thank you, Mr. President, commissioners, and good evening, everyone. Welcome. Great turnout this evening. Just a few rules as we proceed this evening. First, if you've not already done so, please be sure that you place your name on the sign-up sheet if you wish to speak at tonight's forum. Before we begin, we ask that you turn off all cell phones, mobile devices, turn them off completely, or place them on vibrate. The purpose of this public forum is to provide an opportunity for citizens to bring comments, concerns, or questions about any issue that they may have to the attention of the commissioners. Individual speakers will have 3 minutes in which to address the commissioners. Those representing a group or who wish to speak about a particular topic are encouraged to select one spokesperson, and that person will be allotted 5 minutes to address the commissioners. And please be sure, if you are representing a group, to identify yourself as such prior to making your comments. Now, I'm the timekeeper this evening, and I will alert you as to how much when your time is expired. If you have written comments, they are certainly most welcome. And our recorder, Ms. Ferris, who will be sitting there in the middle of the rostrum, will be glad. Here she is. We'll gladly accept them, and they will all become part of the official record. To ensure our viewing audience can hear everything which is being said, we ask that you please make your comments either at the presenter's table or at the microphone there. As a reminder, this is a convened meeting of the Commissioners of St. Mary's County, and the rules of order for St. Mary's County boards and commissions is now in effect. You're asked to address your comments directly to the commissioners and not to the audience. Tonight's public forum is being televised live on St. Mary's County Government TV 95. This forum will be rebroadcast this Sunday evening, March 15th at 7 p.m. Finally, when your name is called, please approach the microphone or the presenter's table from the center aisle. And when you are prepared to speak, we ask that you please do so clearly and to provide your first and last name as well as your full street address for the record. I'm tired. Now that's it. Commissioner President.
Thank you, Mr. Jones, and good evening and welcome. My name is Randy Guy. I'm the President of the County Commissioners of St. Mary's County. I want to introduce our fellow commissioners here. To this side, First Commissioner District Ridge, Piney Point, St. George's Island, Mr. Commissioner Jarbo. In the Second Commissioner District, Leonardtown, Hollywood, Commissioner Hewitt. Third Commissioner District, Charlotte Hall, 7th District, Golden Beach, Commissioner O'Connor.
Evening.
4th Commissioner District, Lexington Park, Summit of California, Great Mills, Commissioner Morgan. Also we have with us today is Dr. Bridget, who is our County Administrator. And of course, Tony has already given you the rules and regulations. Sitting my immediate right is our recorder, Sharon Ferris. She will be taking care of the, taking all the minutes here. Plus this is all being videographed by Miss Amy Carter, who is behind the glass and is being shown live as we speak. And I'm gonna go right to calling on our first person. We have a Rose Frederick.
I wasn't going to speak, I'm sorry.
Do you have a group that's speaking for you, or you got?
Yes.
Okay, and your name, ma'am?
Gail Taylor.
Your name, did you sign up?
Yes, I did.
Okay, come on, please come up front, I'm sorry. See if she's on there.
Well, good evening, commissioners. My name is Dale Taylor.
You can either stand at the microphone or you can sit down if you want to. You can stand right down if you want to. You want to sit down? Go ahead and sit down. Go ahead and be comfortable.
My name is Dale Taylor. I'm the chairperson for the Garvey Senior Activity Center Group. I'm here. This way I can see you. I'm here tonight representing 3,288 St. Mary County citizens who have signed a petition for moving the funds that are in the fiscal year 2018 capital improvement budget to the 2016 budget to begin the planning for a new Garvey Senior Activity Center. We are excited and we're hopeful that we can get a new building and center dedicated to the 50 plus citizens to stay active in body, mind, and spirit. We first all, as my group, wants to thank you all, commissioners, for considering approving moving the funds 2 years earlier. The Garvey Senior Activity Center Group provided a formal presentation and town hall meeting. It was really the first one we've ever done quite like this yesterday to the citizens of St. Mary's County. We had a wonderful turnout, and I'm providing each of you a copy of the brief so you can kind of get a feel for what we're about and what we're trying to get the support to do. We had a large turnout. Our focus was to inform the community of what our original goal was and still is, to obtain approval to move the money to fiscal year 2016. Our accomplishments to date and the next steps forward. So we gave them the whole, what we've done, where we're going, what we hope to accomplish. We are very much aware of all the pressures you all are facing with the emerging ideas from other sources. But our Grow Garvey group will stay focused on our original goal to ask you, the Board of St. Mary's County Commissioners, to please approve the funding, move the funding to the existing funds from 2018 to 2016. And I just would like to turn to the audience and say, if everyone's in favor of this, would you please stand and please support? Thank you. Thank you, Commissioners.
You have a lot of representation here.
Thank you.
Appreciate it, and I assure you that I'm a participant of Garvey. I use it twice a week myself, and I think we do need a good new center. Okay, Mr. David Ryan. Mr. Ryan, good to see you again.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm here tonight on behalf of the Commission on People with Disabilities. And with me is Eric Colvin. He was the previous chairman of the commission. And he was dealing with the same matter that we're talking about tonight last year. The resolution that established the commission gave three specific mandates, one being to be the advocate for people with disabilities in St. Mary's County. And we're here tonight on that premise. I sent you a letter, or I sent the county administrator a letter, which I sent you a copy of, which the letter was not responded to or acknowledged, although Ms. Gebecki did on a related matter. She did get back with me. So we want to make sure that as the advocate for people with disabilities that we go on record as stating what our concerns are about not having a full-time ADA coordinator for St. Mary's County. Now, the Americans with Disability Act was passed in 1990. It was amended in 2008 and again in 2010. It was written by the United States Access Panel. It's enforced by the Justice Department and the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. And there's a growth industry of people who do nothing but advise other people how to comply to the ADA or take remedial actions to comply to the ADA. I attended a conference last year, an ADA conference. Those three entities that I just spoke about presented at that conference, and in open session, they could not agree on certain portions of the law as to what it meant or how it should be applied. So it is a very difficult thing. There's five titles to the ADA. They are overlapping, and they have to be administered together. I came away from the conference with one thing for sure, that you need the wisdom of Solomon to apply the Americans with Disability Act. Now, I would think it would be a question that you could ask me, what facilities in our county do not comply with the ADA? And my answer to you would be, I can't tell you. And I can also tell you there's not a person on the face of the earth who can answer that question. Because we have not done a comprehensive survey of our compliance with ADA of our facilities in the county, at least since the 2010 amendments to the ADA have been made. Presently, you have a part-time ADA coordinator. It's an employee assigned to Parks and Recreations. The ADA responsibilities are in addition to their regular responsibilities, so the ADA is done on a part-time basis. There is no way you're ever going to get a comprehensive study of all your facilities until you designate a person with the requisite knowledge and give them the time to do that study. So right now, Commissioners, you have no idea whether you're in compliance with the law or not. And the ADA is a law. I mean, compliance is not optional, it's mandatory. So we think very strongly that we should have a full-time ADA coordinator in St. Mary's County. Now, there's some benefits to having that, other than just seeing to it that you comply with the law. An ADA coordinator will be a resource that all of your departments could use. There should be a continuing education component to that position, because your employees are dealing with people with special needs every day of the week, and therefore they need to be abreast of the provisions of the ADA. There also can be some cost savings. It would only take one significant remedial order, and that would cost you more than an ADA full-time position for several years. And I don't have to tell you that consultants don't come cheap. Another thing that the ADA coordinator could do, if you allowed it, was allow small businesses to contact that ADA coordinator, because they are also affected by ADA. So it would be a resource for them to comply with ADA. Some of your staff has the opinion that this should be pushed back again as if ADA doesn't exist. We strongly disagree with that. And we want to go on record as the advocate for the people with disabilities, and we feel we have a responsibility to you to say that we strongly recommend that you take a serious look at the advantages and disadvantages or the cost of having a full-time ADA coordinator. So I thank you for your time, and if you have any questions, I'll be glad to try to answer them.
Thank you, Mr. Ryan.
Thank you.
Ms. Bonnie Green.
Ms. Green, before you begin speaking into everyone, please be sure to include your name, your full name and address prior to speaking. We need that for the record. Thank you. Bye.
Good evening. I'm Bonnie Green. I live at 47856 Malls Cove Lane in St. Inigo's, and I'm here to speak this evening in support of funding for the Patuxent River Naval Air Museum. I work for the Patuxent Partnership, an organization that works with government, industry, and academia on science and technology issues, and we support STEM and workforce development. We often use the Patuxent River Naval Air Museum for our programs and to introduce students to STEM initiatives. On Thursday of this week, we'll be having the Patuxent Partnership in COSI Science Fair Awards program at the museum, and I welcome all of you to join us. The museum introduces many students to STEM careers, and in particular, careers in naval aviation. It is accessible to students, to mentors, and to STEM professionals. There are simulators available at the facility, and classroom space will be provided when the new building is completed. TPP, with the support of a grant from the Navy, developed a National Flight Academy aviation classroom experience at the Forest Technology Center. This is a very popular program and introduces students to STEM careers. It helps to educate them in math and science and is a very exciting place for them to be. We are interested, as the Navy is interested, in developing a second such classroom, and the Patuxent River Naval Air Museum would be an ideal location so that the facility would be available to all students and not limited, as it is right now, just to the students in St. Mary's County Public Schools. The museum is a popular destination for visitors, many of whom are visiting St. Mary's County to support Navy-related work, most of which is naval aviation. The Patuxent Partnership and the Association of Naval Aviation have contributed over $5,000 to the museum over the past several years. As a lifetime member of the museum, and with a third grader at home who loves to visit the museum and the flight line, I have seen firsthand how this museum fosters an interest in STEM-related education. Thank you.
Ms. Green, you said Thursday, March 12th. What time?
5 o'clock.
5 p.m.
But please check the website in case, with all the schedule changes due to snow, I have the wrong time. But the students will be displaying their science fair projects, and we'll have a few remarks, and the superintendent of schools will be there. So we hope to see you there.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Jean Towson?
That's right. My name is Gene Townsend. I live at 23274 Nicholson Street in Hollywood, Maryland. I'm the president of the Protection Partnership. I basically support what Bonnie mentioned. Our initiatives are to help with the STEM program, and we want to be able to contribute to that. And one of the ways we can do that is with your support to help with the museum. I also speak as a former board member of the museum, that we have worked there before, and for probably about 10 years doing that, and also the treasurer of the organization. So I know a little bit about how that interfaces with the Navy, and it'd be very important to do that with the STEM program. With our support, we'd be happy to support that. Any questions? Or thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gene. Mark Converse.
Good evening, sir. Mark Converse, reside at 17855 River Shore Drive in Tall Timbers. I'm here to speak as my in my position of the commanding officer of the local squadron of the Association of Naval Aviation. I'm also on the national board of the same organization. So our view is, and our mission is very well aligned with the mission of the museum. So we're here in support of y'all funding the museum and continuing that. And why? Mainly because it really comes down to three things. Again, our mission is well aligned with the mission of the museum. Preserve aviation history, which is rich in this area, of course. It goes back quite a ways. Educate both residents and visitors alike. And to really most importantly, probably to inspire that next generation of military and civilian personnel to come and work here and support the important DOD mission that we all are a part of. So, as Bonnie mentioned, we have 3 to 4 panels a year, and it's a great venue for those panels to help us execute the mission of educating the public on the importance of naval aviation and its contributions to national defense. So, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think I'm pronouncing it as Dennis Gorge.
Yep. George.
Good evening, Mr. President, Commissioners. My name is Dennis Gorge. I live at 22810 Laurel Haven Way in Lexington Park. And I'm here tonight representing the St. Mary's County Advanced Life Support Unit. And I'm joined tonight with a number of my colleagues who I would just ask to stand momentarily. Thank you. So I'm here tonight to discuss the future of St. Mary's County Advanced Life Support, specifically an error in our capital improvement budget submission, which could potentially have devastating consequences for our operation. So I'll talk a little bit more about that in just a minute, but I would like to spend a moment to introduce you to the St. Mary's ALS unit for those who may not be familiar. So, our organization is the sole provider of pre-hospital emergency care at the ALS level, the advanced life support level, and we've been doing so since 1983. We are paramedics that provide this service around the clock, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Our organization is staffed by 48 volunteer paramedics and over 60 support staff, which includes EMTs and drivers. Our paramedics are well-trained, and we bring an advanced skill set to the scene of a life-threatening medical emergency or serious traumatic injury. Our medics are well-prepared, having completed a 2-year study of including classroom and clinical work at an accredited training facility, plus a rigorous internship. And they come well-armed with specialized training and critical life-saving skills and equipment. We're not a standalone service. We don't operate in a vacuum. In fact, we work very closely with the basic life support units, the rescue squads within the county. We typically respond in a chase car, a picture of which you have in the pamphlet that was provided to you. We're pretty busy. We answered almost 5,000 calls last year, 911 calls. If you think about it, that's almost one in three of every dispatch that comes out of the 911 center for fire or EMS prompts a medic unit response. So we are headquartered in Leonardtown. It's a great place because of its central location. However, we do have satellite units which are stationed in Lexington Park and Mechanicsville. We have expanded our operation in what we call our paramedic early intervention program, in which we staff some of the ambulances within the county with paramedics and ALS equipment. Those ambulances are answering about 10% of the advanced life support calls in conjunction with our chase car system. So the reason I'm here tonight is really it's time to move. And so you see that in our brochure. We have outgrown our current facility. We've been there for a little over 25 years, but we've outgrown it, and the facility is leased with no opportunity for expansion. The facility is insufficient for vehicles, the number of vehicles that we have for storing our supplies, equipment, for holding our duty crews, and for the purposes of training new paramedics. Now, facility's been great. The current proprietor of the building has been outstanding. They're very considerate of our circumstances, but they would like to repurpose the building. They have plans for it. They're not ready to throw us out, but the handwriting is on the wall. Our lease is up in 3 years, and it is time, excuse me, it is time for us to move on and find a new headquarters. So we've been planning for our future, and so we have provided some additional requests for funding. Now, our financial situation is a little unique. Unlike the fire departments and the rescue squads, we do not do active fundraising. This is because we do not want to compete with the rescue squads and fire departments. We don't want to knock on somebody's door twice, one for the rescue squad, one for the ALS unit. So we do accept donations, although we do not solicit donations. So it's a little confusing for the public, but it also relieves our memberships from double duty, having to fundraise for two EMS organizations. That said, our operating funds come out of the emergency services tax. And so with that, and we've been operating under that for some time, but there has been no capital improvement provided for the ALS unit since about the mid-1980s. So we did request a capital improvement budget submission for FY16 and 17. The FY16 funding, and you have a copy of this, it's in your packet there. FY16 included funding to complete the architectural and engineering requirements to develop a new station for the medic unit, with construction coming in FY17.
Time, Mr. Gorge.
Mr. President,
please, could you give him 3 minutes, please?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. President.
Go ahead.
Thank you, sir.
So unfortunately, the budget that you reviewed had the construction funds erroneously placed in FY16 and omitted the A&E funds requested by the medic unit. So not surprisingly, the request was declined, and rightfully so. So tonight we're asking you to reconsider our FY16 budget in light of the apparent error. Then, as I said, you do have a handout of our submission. So the estimated cost for the A&E is $173,000 based on estimates from reputable local builders. Of the 173, the medic unit is able to provide 43,000 of that from our in-house funds. So that leaves a shortfall of 130,000 that we're asking you to place in our FY16 budget so that we may complete the A&E for the new station. The plan is to increase from our current facility, which is about 2,500 square feet, to a little over 6,000 square feet. And I think you have a drawing of a concept for our new facility. So this would give us four vehicle bays and adequate training and storage facilities. So I know times are tough, and I know that meeting a request such as this isn't easy, but we do come to you with this as a need and not as a want or a desire. So we would offer to provide a tour of our current facility and to sit down and discuss this with you in more detail. So again, thank you for the time tonight. Thank you for your steadfast support for the medic unit over the last 31 and a half years. We do hope that you'll help us plan for a suitable home for the ALS unit for the next 30 years. And hope that you will reconsider our FY16 budget. And I would like to just say for the public that the medic unit is always looking for volunteers. And so we would welcome you to come out and join. However, we draw our personnel from our sister organizations, and that would be the local fire departments and rescue squads. So we ask that you come out and support your rescue squad, your fire department, and consider volunteering. Thank you.
Mr. Andrew Hackney? Andrew Hackney? Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, good. Okay, Paul Kelly?
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Paul Kelly. I live at 41885 Medley's Neck Road, Leonardtown, Maryland. And I'm here to discuss the location of a new county library to replace the current facility located in the former Armory building. At the outset, I would like to emphasize that we are discussing a county library. Therefore, in your deliberations, I would ask that you consider the needs of the county as opposed to the needs of a small group of commercial interests. Several years ago, your predecessors held a series of public meetings in which the issue of the county's requirements for library facilities were addressed. It was at one of these meetings where a graphic design was presented and discussed. Illustrating on that design was two schools, a primary and a middle school, a library, sports facility, and a nature area. I immediately recognized the potential educational opportunity the design presented. Briefly, some of the site's advantages are as follows. Number one, the county already owns the land. Two, the schools and the library would be co-located in walking distance of one another. And three, there is sufficient land to allow for future expansion of the library to meet future needs. Gentlemen, the most compelling reason to build the new county library on the original projected site is the opportunity to enhance our children's educational experience. Imagine, if you will, the following scenario. The month is March, the schools are teaching the solar system, and the school staff and the library staff have coordinated programs and material to reinforce this activity. The library staff has assembled a whole range of diverse materials and made arrangements for special programs throughout the month, including outside experts for presentation. Gentlemen, this is such an exciting and rare opportunity for educational experience like this. Young astronomers, astrophysicists, astronauts are created. Please don't let this opportunity pass us by. This is really an opportunity not only to build a library, but to enhance our children's educational experience. And in closing, PPP, public-private partnership. For those not aware, this is a methodology whereby the commissioners are able to alleviate some of the taxpayer burden. So thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Christopher, is it?
Yes.
Jace?
my name is Christopher Jace. I live at 41820 Eastwick Lane, Leonardtown, Maryland. Good evening, County Commissioners. I'm here this evening to speak to you about the Tuxent River Naval Air Museum. During the 9 years that I've lived in this county, I've been a part of or attended several events at the museum, such as retirement ceremonies, receptions, galas, business forums, and educational opportunities. I've had the privilege of being an active volunteer there and have encouraged other citizens to contribute their time there as well. Many of these volunteer opportunities have developed skill sets amongst our county youth, which have assisted in the growth of their confidence and professionalism. This museum has built camaraderie amongst the citizens of this community and has been a link to our past and present naval aviation. Recently, the Naval Air Museum has received a lot of press that has led many to question how the operation will move forward. That is, will the county fund the operations of the museum? Although some are concerned about the recurring costs that this will have in the county budget, it is my understanding that the museum wishes to sustain its own operations but cannot expeditiously do so without your assistance and action. In other words, the museum is only looking for assistance as they open the new museum. There is no intention for operations to become a recurring cost in the county budget. As Commissioner Jarba said, if we don't open the doors, it sends a terrible message to the community. I say this to you, let's send the right message. Last year, a comprehensive economic development strategy was commissioned for St. Mary's County, and it will assist in diversifying our economy and mitigating any future impacts from potential sequesters in the federal government. Our acting economic and community development director, Robin Finnecom, stated that we also look at things we continue to care about, like tourism. The Patuxent River Naval Air Museum and the opening of the new building will play an important role in tourism. With the right marketing and the support of the community, the museum will attract not only those who already have an interest in naval aviation, but new interests as well. I have confidence that our county government and the staff of the Naval Air Museum can work together to come up with a sustainable business solution for the museum operations, but more importantly, can work together to open the new museum when construction is complete. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm hoping I do this right. Lynn Hawken?
Lynn Newkirk.
Newkirk, I'm sorry. I can't read my own writings. I can't read yours either, I'm sorry.
Handwriting has never been one of my strongs.
My name is Carol Romery. I live at 23081 Silk Oak Way in California. Lynn Newkirk, Janice Walther, and Jim Hanley and I are members of the Library Board of Trustees. At our monthly meeting this morning, the Board of Library Trustees unanimously voted to recommend that the new library be built next to the new Duke Elementary School at the entrance of Leonard's Grant. This site allows for construction of a single-story structure with both adequate parking space and room for future expansion. A multiple-story library requires additional staffing that can cost as much as $150,000 per year in annual operating expenses, accruing year after year for the entire life of the library. In October 2011, during the prior new library project, the library board voiced these same concerns regarding the lack of adequate space and an increased operating cost associated with the proposed alternate site. Also, only about 30% of the patrons of the library located in Leonardtown actually live in Leonardtown. The remaining 70%, for the most part, live in the Hollywood, California area. Therefore, for most of the patrons of the new library would not be contributing to traffic congestion in Leonard's Grant. They would simply use the entrance to Leonard's Grant to access the library. Finally, as a St. Mary's County resident, I want to personally thank the county commissioners for their support and desire to enhance our wonderful library system. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think it's Barbara Ives.
Good evening, commissioners. President and Commissioner, my name is Barbara Ives. I live at 23785 Kingston Creek Road, California, Maryland. I'm here to talk about the Air Museum, support the Air Museum. I'm on the board of directors for the Air Museum, and as a retired captain of over 27 years in the Navy, I see and I know the value and importance of this museum. Not only the value and importance in the history of naval aviation in this county and in this area, but just as importantly, to the history of this county and the development of this county. The museum was formed by volunteers that loved what they did. They loved naval aviation. And that love shined through because they got it going. They built it. Since then, it's been run by volunteers. They make it happen. They work very hard. They spend time out of their busy days to make this museum work. This sort of commitment is truly noble, and it reflects a great dedication and love, not only for Naval Aviation, but also for this county and the success of this county. Since the building land and the building itself is owned by the county, it just makes good sense that the county maintains it. Two, it makes good sense that the museum is included within the county museum system, just as Piney Point, just as St. Clements, and of course, St. Mary City. The museum is a county treasure, a treasure and a major tourist site, a place folks go. Folks learn about history, to participate in great simulators and understand what the county's about. Also, the museum offers unlimited possibilities for future operations in STEM activities, similar to what Bonnie mentioned earlier on, as well as community organization meeting sites, which it's always busy doing. The museum is a very, very busy place. But to do all this and to support all these operations and to help all these folks out that are citizens of the county, we need to have the building maintained. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Having a hard time with his nickname, but I'll try here. Is it Gerber? You live in Park Hall? Is it Ern? No, I'm sorry, you're not speaking. That's, sorry about that. We'll let that go. Leslie Roberts?
Good evening. My name is Leslie Roberts. I live at 22560 Key Way in Leonardtown. I am a Leonardtown Council member, but I'm also a citizen who uses the library frequently, sometimes as often as once a week, depending on how many papers I have to grade. I think the most important point to be made this evening is that we need a new library. I was not surprised when you decided to revisit the issue of a new library on the Leonard's Grant site, because I knew you had all heard about the need for a new building while you were campaigning. I was impressed that you brought this issue to the table immediately upon taking office. The mayor and some members of the council want to have the library built on a downtown site. Mayor Burris sent a letter to the county commissioners and the library board last month listing the strengths of the downtown site and the weaknesses of the Leonard Grant site. Though his signature alone was on the letter, it was on the town letterhead and talked about the town and the things it wanted or was ready to do. I felt that anyone reading this letter might assume that the council had voted or reached consensus on this issue. And I just wanted to make sure that the county commissioners, the library board, and the public knew that my opinion on this issue differs from the mayor's. Both sites have their strengths and weaknesses. For me, the deciding factor was which site Kathleen Reif, the library system director, and the library board feels most meets the needs of a new library. They are the experts, and they have spent years thinking about and discussing the pros and cons of these sites. I certainly wouldn't begin to tell Christine Ray where she should put a new building for the hospital or how it should be designed. We need a new library, and we need it now. Using the Leonard's Grant site allows the commissioners and the library board to begin moving forward immediately. I do not want the town's push for a downtown site to keep this much-needed project from moving forward or to affect the great working relationship we have always had with the county commissioners. So I must support the plan to build a new library on the Leonard's Grant site. Even though I am a Leonardtown Council member, I believe sometimes you have to think of the greater good. And I think the people of St. Mary's County would be best served by a new library at Leonard's Grant, rather than a contentious battle over a library site, which, my greatest fear of all, ends with no new library being built at all. So I ask you to move forward with the new library project starting with this budget cycle. It would be a wonderful legacy for your terms in office. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
George Herbert, is that right?
Yep.
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is George Hilbert. I live at 44491 Whitestone Place, Tall Timbers, Maryland. I'm here this evening to represent a 30-year-old institution that has been in this community since 1975, the Patuxent River Naval Air Museum. I have served in the capacity for the museum since 1978 as a member of the board on and off for approximately 28 years, retiring last year as the treasurer of the museum. I am now an emeritus board member by election of the board, so I think I left in good standing. The bottom line on the museum is that we, in fact, did not donate the $1.5 million that we were expected to donate as a function of the State Highway Administration MOU. We donated $1.57 million, an additional $68,000, to the creation of the new building, which is underway right now. We also, during that period, and continue to do so, raise on the average, without a tremendous amount of effort, I must say, during that early period, but a growing effort at this point, raised about $150,000 a year for operations of the museum and have maintained operations of that museum for the duration of 30 years, running on local and community donations. Today, I think I can report successfully that the new board is energized, the new board is proactive, and the new board has leadership. That's one reason I left. The good news is that board has increased the sales in the gift shop. There is increased turnout at the museum, despite the fact that there's a lot of construction going on out front, which makes it less than attractive to attend. There is increased events. The membership, a very significant part of this, has grown, which means that there's growing community interest. We need to do more. We need to grow more. But the opportunity is there, the potential is there, and I believe with adequate planning, we can make that happen. Furthermore, I would suggest one thing. Continuing the museum in its current form and enhancing it is a win-win situation for everybody concerned. Conversely, the opposite is true. To continue the museum, what does that mean? It means that if we're going to build an institution that is truly supporting diversity in this community, we consider the leisure and hospitality industry, which is 10.1% of our population's employment in 2012. Number five industry in this county. The museum represents that industry. It's not about the displaying of artifacts. It's about bringing people into the community and making them aware. Furthermore, the museum provides a vital gateway for the Navy to explain what the heck this stuff called UAVs, unmanned air vehicles, are all about to an otherwise unaware and perhaps skeptical public who does not understand necessarily what that is unless they're intimately involved on the base. And even then, there are only a few that are so intimately involved as to really understand the technology behind it. This begins to feed the discourse for what our research center is all about. It is an important adjunct to our dialogue. Importantly, along with that comes the element of education. A number of speakers preceding me have spoken to the value of the museum as it supports STEM. I add STEAM, the idea of design, artfulness, and it supports the notion of supporting and continue to support the Flight Academy under the St. Mary's County Public Schools. For these reasons, I believe that the museum is critical if we are serious as a community in talking about this notion of diversity. If we are not, I think the demise of the museum would be send a very loud signal to the effect that we do not support diversity. I would further add that the community has a need, and the board of the museum has a need, to engage the community and get them involved in the museum as a part of the function. I recognize that. But I would submit that they cannot successfully do so or may not have the confidence to do so if the government shows some wavering or some concern about the continuation of this 30-year-old institution. Gentlemen, ladies, I thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Scott Starkey. Mm-hmm. Scott Starkey.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Captain Scott Starkey. I'm the executive officer for Naval Air Station Patuxent River. My address at work is 22268 Cedar Point Road, building 409. I'm here tonight simply, I'm as the executive officer, I'm the liaison, the Navy liaison to the Pax River Naval Air Museum. And I wanna just simply say tonight that we have a close working relationship. I attend all the board meetings and will continue to do so. And I wanna submit that relationship in front of you tonight. That's all I have, commissioners, unless there's any questions.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Is it Eric Colvin?
Colvin.
Sorry, he was up with Abraham.
He was up here
earlier. Oh, he's right, Abraham. It's okay. Okay, I'm on down. Is that Sandra Callahan?
I'm not here as a speaker, commissioners, but I'm here as a Navy wife of 30 years, and I support the Naval Aviation Museum.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Paul Callahan?
Commissioners, I'm also a county resident and here to support the Air Museum.
Thank you very much, sir. Wes Hester.
Good evening, commissioners. I am Colonel Wes Hester, United States Air Force, retired. I live in 2180 River Drive, King George, Virginia. I'm here to talk about the museum with you, and you're probably wondering why would a guy from King George is in the Air Force be standing up here? Eloquent. Thank you. I want to roger up what you have already heard, and I want to tell you from a little bit different angle, from two different perspectives, why I think the museum is doing such an excellent job for the Navy, for the community, and for the youth of our country that are out there. I had the privilege of being a base commander, and during an era when we had a lot more outreach that we could do with the community. It's not that long ago, the folks down at Dahlgren will tell you stories about, we came to the base pool, we came to the base theater, we got on the base, just as the community could do. 9/11 changed all that for us. Being able to outreach and interact with the community becomes much, much more of a challenge for the folks that are wearing the suits active duty now. This museum is the biggest gate guard you've ever seen to bring people's attention to what goes on at PAX. The stories that come from inside not only are the history of naval aviation, they are the history of what's going on today. And when they hear the sound of freedom that sometimes you get to hear about too in a negative way, they can understand what's going on. I'd also point out, come on down to Dahlgren and listen to the railgun. Then you can hear the sound of freedom, and this will sound pretty good. Anyway, so for that perspective, from the base being able to interact and having that fulcrum in the front door there, it's very, very powerful. And I'm sure the base appreciates that as well as the community. The second thing I would talk to you about is from just little personal vignettes. I've only been there about 6 months now, but I'm the docent coordinator, docent being the storytellers and also sort of the watchkeepers during the week as people come in and out. And the stories are amazing. You'll meet a retired couple that is coming in to check on a marker that they are putting up as a cobblestone memorial to someone in their family. You'll meet kids that are going out to see a Meet the Airplane event. They want a personal tour of an aircraft that one of their loved ones that they know in their family wants to learn more about it, so they'll come to you. When we talk about our simulator program, we started a new class this past weekend. There were probably six kids from the local high schools that are stepping up to learn to be instructors in the simulator. So it's always something that we can bring and take back and forth with the youth and the community. Those two things I would tell you about from maybe a unique perspective and say thank you for your support. And I look forward to being out there with you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I'm also a retired Air Force.
So he was listening.
Yeah. Too many times today. Go Army.
Coast Guard's best. But that's another story.
Is it Daniel Hing? Okay, I'm sorry, I have a little problem. Daniel Hins or Hing? Oh, I'm sorry, maybe not speaking. That's okay. Ron Bremer? Sorry, Bremer.
Well, I came back to this area this year. I was stationed down here in 1968. When you left the main gate down there, there was nothing down here. 235 in Georgetown was my favorite spot. I spent over 40 years in commercial aviation, 32 years of it as a maintenance supervisor. This air museum goes down, you're going to do this county and future generations an injustice. Before 9/11, we used to bring kids up to BWI. Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, church groups, you name it. My leads or myself, we would take them out and we'd run a Category 3B landing simulation on an aircraft where they could see everything working. We'd take them up to the control tower where they could watch the controllers behind a glass controlling the aircraft in on ground control down landing. I'd never seen anybody so thrilled in their life as those children were to see this going on and never have seen it. I have volunteered at the museum when I came back this year. I'm going to submit a little photographs of some pictures. There are the 8th Air Force Museum in Savannah, Georgia, and of a museum in Titusville, Florida. I don't know how many of you are aware of it. All the work done in that museum is done by volunteers. Most of them are ex-aviation personnel that compare them. Down in Titusville, Florida, my ex-boss does all the test flights on the aircraft and everything, and test them. The aircraft are in various stages of repair, are flyable. All of them will be put back to flying status. You don't have no Blue Angels airplanes sitting out here in front of there. They got two of them sitting out down here in Titusville, Florida. All right. The one airplane that they go in here, and I can go in more of this if you want, and this is for everybody's knowledge. They got a C-47 that was a paratroop drop on D-Day. And they repaired it back to flying status. They actually came across the two guys that flew it and brought them, took them up, and the guys flew the airplane. They got seats on one side, and they got a parachute drop on the other side. You pay $300, you set in a C-47, you go up, the paratroopers are on their left side, they bail out, they circle over and they watch the paratroopers go down. My boss, Tommy, flies that aircraft. He sat in it one Saturday for 10 hours, and he never had a line, just keep coming and coming. You're going to be missing a great opportunity if you don't put this museum through. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I forgot my address. Sorry about that. My name is Ron Bremer. I live at 44875 Dot Bannigan Lane, Leonardtown, Maryland. But I'm not, don't live in Leonardtown. It's actually Valley Lee. Everybody goes looking for me. I'll explain these if you want. I got tons and tons more.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Roger Mattingly.
Good evening, gentlemen and ladies. My name is Roger Mattingly. I live at 41810 Eastwick Lane, Leonardtown, Maryland. I'm a member of the Leonardtown Town Council. And like my good friend Leslie here, we both support that library being at the Hayden Farm. I know there was a letter sent from the mayor of Leonardtown concerning the location of the Leonardtown branch of the St. Mary's County Library. The location of the library was discussed at a town council meeting we had on February the 9th. We as a group agreed to wait until all the facts are in, and the county commissioners clearly stated that they were going to build a library. The council also agreed to come back together, discuss the situation, and give the county our recommendation. That was never done. The mayor took it upon himself to write the letter and send to you guys his personal feelings. Mm-hmm. The library is a very important part of our county and especially our town. I firmly believe the right place for the library is a Hayden Farm. First, the county already owns that farm location. If you use the land from the Fenwick Street location, we will be taking the land off the tax rolls in Leonardtown, and we certainly don't want to do that. Bear in mind the Hayden Farm location is still within the town limits, so it's still the Leonardtown Library. Second, with the location on the Hayden Farm, the library could be all on one floor, thus reducing the operating cost because of additional staff needed to provide service on two floors. The parcel on Leonard's Grand Parkway is 5 acres. The two parcels on Tudor Hall Farm is only 3.5 acres. No room for expansion. Third, the location of the library at the Hayden Farm would be an asset to the Walter Francis Duke Elementary School, which reflects Maryland's smart growth principle by co-locating a library with schools and playing fields. This would also be an asset to two of the largest subdivisions in the county, Leonard's Grant that has some 300 homes, Clark's Rest with another 300 homes. All these people, these two neighborhoods are going to be connected together, and that's 600 homes, or a little more than 600 homes, actually, and they're going to have kids there. These people will be able to walk to that library. Kids will be able to ride their bicycles to the library, and that would be a huge asset. And fourth, as a town council member, I have not seen any documentation or heard any conversation that the state would build a road through the Tudor Hall Farm. In case, and I'm sure you all are familiar, you know, it was a road, it was talked about a road going from Route 5 into Clark's Rest area through Tudor Hall Farm to come up behind Fenwick Street, to meet Fenwick Street. But I've never seen any conversation with Mr. Pleasance, the owner of the Tudor Hall Farm, with the time frame for development of the Tudor Hall Farm or any kind of road construction. In closing, it only makes sense that my wholehearted support goes to the new Leonardtown Library to be located at the Hayden Farm. And gentlemen and ladies, thank you very much. I appreciate
it. Thank you, Mr. Manley.
Thank you, Roger.
Thank you.
Roderick Lewis.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm Janice Walthour, 20493 Partons Lane, Lexington Park, Maryland. And tonight, our spokesperson for the NAACP is Andrea Bowman, our president, but she is not able to be here tonight due to work conditions. She's at work.
Okay, sure. That makes sense. That's good.
So we have, she has asked us to have one of our community coordination chairperson, Roderick Lewis, will be our spokesperson in line with our goal, national, state, and local goal of economic sustainability, jobs for all, not just the skilled, and not just the professional, but the skilled, the trades folks, and especially pulling folks from out of that poverty range into the middle and upper economic range. So Roderick is our spokesperson. He has a short talk for you, and we have our other executive committee members here with us. Sure. Young people, the Lord answers prayers.
thank you, County Commissioners.
State your name and address.
Roderick Lewis, address 20820 Skipjack Court, Lexington Park, Maryland. Like in a recent op-ed piece the NAACP wrote a couple days ago, I think it was in the last Friday's papers, we would like to thank the St. Mary's County Commissioners for putting up $1 million towards the needed $3.8 million for the Southern Maryland Higher Education Center Building 3. It was a bold step, and hopefully our state legislators and our governor recognize that, and they take you up on that offer that you guys offered them. I also want to bring to your attention and to the public's attention a petition that is at change.org. If you go to change.org and search Save Building 3, a petition is there that is being sent to our Southern Maryland delegation and the governor, urging them to reinstate the total 3.8, only needed 2.8 now since the county commissioners have showed them how to do things. They have taken the lead on this issue. So if you go there, you will see the petition, information about Building 3, and along with several comments from the public on why this building needs to happen and why they need to reinstate the funding. The main issue is that it will help diversify our economy. We all want to further diversify the economy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Carol Romary. Oh, yours. I'm sorry. Okay, sorry. Is it Rothborn? Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm DeForest Rathbone, 18816 McKay's Beach Road, Leonardtown, Maryland. And I'm here on behalf of the parents group in Southern Maryland, parent anti-drug movement. If you remember, this time last year, the board and other institutions in St. Mary's County sponsored a drug summit up at the firehouse in Hollywood. About 600 people showed up, and after that, actually surprised people, and after that some of the parents got together and continued meeting, and we found out that the drug problem that everybody was concerned about was much worse than anybody ever knew. So what I'm doing here is giving you a report, a one-year report from things that have happened since then. It's too long to go over here, but you'll see it summarized with some backup information. Basically, what it is that things are getting worse instead of better, and there's some reasons for that. One of the main reasons is that out in Colorado, they're allowed to manufacture and produce and sell illegal drugs, marijuana specifically, of any strength, and it's being distributed throughout the nation, and it's able to be picked up by the kids through their cell phones, and it's sent to them through the mails. So there's no way in the world police or anybody else can stop this thing. It's coming to them. And this stuff is of such high strength that it's creating a lot of psychosis among people. And there's not much you can do about that. But what we can do is prevent the kids from getting started on it at the beginning. And that's what the parents have proposed, that we do some health screening for the kids in the schools. You put up $100,000 last year after that conference, after that summit, and it was sent to the health department, and they're using it for one of the things is for screening kids through the school system. It's called SBIRT, S-B-I-R-T, screening, brief intervention, and referral for treatment. And this is very similar to other programs that are in use around the country that screen the kids to make sure that they don't get involved with drugs to start with. Another terrible thing has happened here, and people don't know about it. But even with everybody paying attention to the drug problem, a young student up at Choptank High School died of a heroin overdose death last January. Not many people know about it. It was kind of suppressed. We don't understand why this kind of information can't be made public and with a reaction by government so that we start doing something about this. But if nobody knows about it, everybody goes back to sleep. Obviously, the kid, as a 16-year-old, didn't go up to Baltimore and get the heroin himself. Somebody fed it to him. There was a crime committed. In some areas, people are prosecuting the suppliers of this stuff to the victims for murder. So there's a lot going on here, but the one thing is that this analysis that I've given you here that you can look over, and I got it available for anybody else who wants to see it, recaps what's been going on during the year and what we're proposing to do about it. You need a central coordinator of some kind. The call him a drug czar or whatever, to kind of keep track of this so we make sure all the different components of schools and governments are working together to solve this problem. Otherwise, it's going to get worse. There's going to be more of these overdose deaths. It's a national problem, and all communities have it, but it's easily solved at the lowest level by preventing the kids from getting involved in it to start with. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Is it Mike Anderson, Jr.?
Yep.
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Mike Alderson. I live at 38185 Beach Road, Colton's Point. I'm here representing St. Mary's Northern Soccer League, and I'd like to see a sports complex built for soccer, lacrosse, and indoor facilities for basketball and indoor soccer. We would base this loosely on the complex that is in Montgomery County called the Germantown Soccerplex. That facility has 24 fields. We only want 9, one stadium and 8 outlying fields. And like I said before, the indoor size for indoor soccer with 4 indoor basketball courts. The Soccerplex bought in last year $30.2 million for Montgomery County through tournaments and through 12 tournaments that were youth tournaments and one national tournament. Washington Spirit Women's Soccer League plays there, and they bought in $700,000. I realize those numbers are unattainable for this county, but I think if we can build a facility like this for half the price and make half that amount, it will pay for itself eventually, without a doubt. This weekend, our combined league, St. Mary's Youth and Northern Soccer, is hopefully sponsoring a tournament, the first leg of a 2-weekend tournament that's sponsoring. It will be 54 teams in this tournament. Of those 54 teams, 38 of them are from outside of Southern Maryland. Those 38 teams are going to have at least 11 players per team, and their parents are going to want to drive back to Northern Virginia, Pennsylvania, or West Virginia to spend the night, to turn around and come back down the road. Another reason we want to build a facility like this is that with this tournament, we had the teams playing at Chaptico, we have them playing at St. Mary's College, we have them playing at Riken and at Chancellor's. There's really no reason for a county our size with the resources we have to spread these visitors to our county all over the county. Having one central location in the county, close to your restaurants, close to the soon-to-be-completed movie theater, and close to the hotels. It only makes good fiscal sense, and it will help grow soccer and lacrosse, rugby, and other sports in this in the county. We have verbal support from U.S. Soccer and D.C. United already, and the Nike Charitable Foundation will only entertain any requests for funds if the county has made a significant step towards a viable plan. And my plan would be to do a public and private partnership with Under Armour, which is a Maryland-based company, with DC United, with Nike, to see who is willing to pitch in to help grow the sport in our county. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Mike Barber.
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Mike Barber, 21212 Bernie Lawrence Lane, Able, Maryland, down the middle of the beautiful 7th District. And actually, I came tonight to use this forum as a forum of awareness. Something that comes to my mind as I drive around looking at everything, the new buildings we have, and taking pride in the Maryland flag, the United States flag, being retired Navy myself. But as you look at the Maryland flag, if I could direct your attention over to this flag here, you'll see at the top of the staff a gold botany cross. And that is required by the state code, the annotated Code of Maryland, Chapter 7, Article 7, Tact 203, that any time you have the Maryland flag on a pole or a staff, that it be adorned by the Gold Cross Botany. Now, at the Northern Center, the Loeffler Center, in front of the Metcom building, I'm not sure who's responsible in front of the Pax River Naval Air Museum, but all of these poles have a brass ball on top of it. And to me, I just look at it and say, you know, we're the mother county of Maryland. If we don't set the example with our government buildings and have the correct adornment on the Maryland flag, then we're not really setting a good example for the hotels and all these other places that I see going up. And I love to see the flags, the patriotism, both in the nation, the state, and county. But you can go up and down Route 235 and see these new hotels going up, and they've got a brass ball. Well, they don't know any better, I believe. Mm-hmm. So it's a matter of awareness. And the good news is it's relatively inexpensive to swap that out and put the correct finial on there. So that's all I have. Just wanted to bring it to your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you. Something new every night.
I know.
First time. I want to admit, that's the first time I've learned really something new here.
Mike is also a legionnaire down at 221, and he keeps us trimming all the flag adequate. Thomas Brewer.
That's probably another 40 in the slip, you know.
Good evening. I represent the Commission on the Environment, but I don't think I'll need more than 3 minutes of your time. Sure. Thank you for holding this public forum. My name is Thomas Brewer, and I am representing the Commission on the Environment, as I said. We have come up with some suggestions to decrease the amount of solid waste produced in the county, as we feel this is one of the most pressing environmental concerns that we as a community can effectively change. Our main focus right now regards composting, which provides us with a great way to decrease solid waste production. But at present, there are no available private facilities to compost the food waste in our area. Since the county pays for solid waste to be hauled from public schools, and because the majority of the school's solid waste is compostable food waste, we believe that public schools are a great place to start. With Captain Walter France Duke Elementary intended to be certified as a LEED Gold building, this seems to be an ideal site to initiate a composting project. An on-site in-vessel composting setup would decrease the amount of waste hauled from the schools and provide soil amendment for the property, both saving money for the public school system. We are working with the Board of Education to put together a detailed report outlining a recommended plan of action regarding the composting project, and we look forward to presenting that to you in the near future. Some less urgent topics we have been researching regard plastic grocery bags and the recycling rate in the county. Plastic grocery bags are not recycled by conventional means via the single stream recycling system in place, and few people are aware of this. The only way they are recycled presently is through the plastic bag drop-off receptacles at grocery stores. They're pressed under high pressure to create durable textiles like benches and stuff. For this reason, the commission suggests that the county consider a plastic bag fee or consider requiring that plastic bag drop-off receptacles be in the stores that use plastic bags, as we believe an outright ban would not go over well within the community. We also suggest the county consider a pay-as-you-throw program that charges for trash disposal at transfer stations, but not for recycling disposal, in an effort to increase the recycling rate in our county. There are a variety of techniques that have been implemented around the state and across the country regarding plastic bag fees and pay-as-you-throw programs. And we at the Commission on the Environment would be happy to put together a report on either issue to weigh the pros and cons of the different approaches that have been taken in order to determine an appropriate method for our county. At this time, I thank you for the opportunity to speak on behalf of the Commission on the Environment, and I encourage you to contact us with any questions or concerns that you might have. If you have any questions for me right now, I'd be glad to attempt to field them.
So, Mr. Brewer, for the record,
yes,
plastic grocery bags aren't acceptable with a single stream. One would argue probably then the clear plastic bags that most people put the recycling in and then drop them in the single stream are also not.
And that's something we're going to try to educate people on at Earth Day in the Square, Leonardtown. So that's not commonly known. People don't realize. Until last year, I put all of my recycling into a grocery bag thinking, boom, I now have everything recycled. I'm doing a good job. And then I found out that they're called MRFs, Material Recovery Facility, the one that we just built up in Elk Ridge. Mm-hmm. They sort everything with amazing technology, air bursts and lasers that separate different plastics. But all the grocery bags and all the trash bags just get thrown away. So I think that's something that people aren't aware of, so I'd like to very much raise awareness. And I think that having the trash receptacles and a sign saying, you know, simply that putting them in the Chancellor Station is the same as stowing them away, just so people are aware. I just think that it kind of out of sight, out of mind right now.
Well, thanks for coming out. There's more people aware.
Can you give me your address, please?
Yeah, sorry about that. My address is 23320 Laurel Hill Drive, California, Maryland.
And if I could suggest, the Commissioner of the Environment is appointed by the commissioners. I would suggest possibly, you know, instead of coming out Tuesday night for 5 minutes, to spend some time to come before us at a regular meeting so we can brief the public more adequately on, you know, the whole environment thing. Yeah. And you have two of the council members sitting right there about the recycling and the composting at Duke Elementary. There you go.
We'll be at their meeting on the 20th to try and promote the Sustainable Maryland certification process, which is a process started by the University of Maryland system where they give priority access to grants and incentives through the state. There are 156 municipalities in Maryland that are incorporated. Leonardtown is the only one in St. Mary's County, so it is accessible to the certificate process they have. So I think pairing that with the project would be beneficial for the county.
Cool.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much. Carolyn Williamson.
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Carolyn Williamson, and I live at 18061 Shipping Point Road, St. Mary's City. I'm speaking tonight for the Friends of the Library of St. Mary's County as a board member. The board members applaud your decision to move beyond the idea of renovating the existing Leonardtown Library. Anyone who has used that library's services knows that the adequate renovation would be impossible because the building is over 60 years old, it is designated historic, therefore renovation would be limited to its current 19,000 square feet. A study made way back in 2007 stated that adequate library space for the Leonardtown population needed to be at least 44,000 square feet, and that was 8 years ago. We, the Friends of the Library board members, want a new library in Leonardtown, one with adequate space and flexible layout for the many services and programs that this library offers. We want a new library that is easily accessible for all Leonardtown area citizens, from preschoolers and their caregivers to our senior citizens. I understand that two sites are under consideration. Please keep in mind that the 2007 study recommended a minimum of 5 acres for the building site to provide enough parking space for patrons and staff. The people of Leonardtown and St. Mary's County deserve no less. We are grateful to you for appreciating and supporting the St. Mary's County Library System. We thank you for the time and energy you are devoting to the future of the Leonardtown Library. It is for you to decide on the building and on its location. Please consider the thousands of patrons who use this library each month, not only those from Leonardtown, but from other surrounding areas. Deliberate carefully and spend our money well. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Mr. Tom Mattingly.
Thank you, Commissioners. I had hoped that we would be nearing the opportunity to cut a ribbon on a new library in Leonardtown, but it looks like we're reinventing the wheel again. But much has been recently talked about the proposal to build a new Leonardtown branch of the St. Mary's County Library System. And this is one of the first points that needs to be clarified. It is the St. Mary's County Library, not the Leonardtown Library, and the town certainly has not ever offered to provide any funding to support the library. Over 97% of the patrons of the library drive to Leonardtown to visit the library. At the current location on Hollywood Road, outside of the downtown business district, which is frequently used by many of the patrons. Approximately 66% are not even in the Leonardtown 20650 zip code. Now, not just Leonardtown proper, the entire zip code. It has been located on Hollywood Road for 28 years. The new location proposed is about a half a mile from the current location and in the Leonardtown Development District, identified in the county's comprehensive plan and developed based on the Department of State Planning and its smart growth principles. The planning for the proposed library and the ultimate location of the new facility was developed by a review of the facility, the current master plan, evaluation of the community's needs, not just Leonardtown's, and a recommendation in February of 2009 after reviewing several sites to be considered as a result of the library board study and the county's budget process. Based on that public process and recommendations by the Library Board of Trustees, the consideration of the Hayden Farm as the most suitable site was made. One might read in the Department of State Planning's publications on smart growth that you need to see location, you need to see that locations for schools, public parks, and libraries, and yes, even senior centers, on the perimeter of the town center is considered following the growth principles due to the fact that large parcels of property are not typically available in the downtown business districts. This is exactly the case in Leonardtown, and it would seem appropriate that one would look to develop schools, parks, and libraries in an area that is provided, that provides for the residents of the town to walk to these facilities. In particular, Leonard's Grant, Clark's Rest currently under construction, Singletree with 150-some homes, and the soon-to-be-annexed farm across the highway from Leonard's Grant, which will provide for probably another, at least another 100 homes. The effort, this effort is exactly what caused the Lexington Park Library to take 13 years to develop. I'm very proud of the fact that I was on the board of county commissioners, board of BOCC, we don't use that anymore. I was on the board of county commissioners at a time when we approved the construction of the library in Lexington Park. And you may know that the circulation for St. Mary's County Library System, Lexington Park is number one in the Tri-County area. Leonardtown, even with the inadequate facilities that we have there today, is number two. And I would submit that if we build a new library in Leonardtown, it may move to number one. The former mayor and the current mayor and the town council were well aware of the purchase of the Hayden Farm property prior to its purchase and the county's plan to put public facilities on that property. The former mayor, the town administrator, and Mr. Burris, the current mayor, participated in the development of the proposed Board of Education SREP and made no comments during the day-long work session objecting to the location, only to come out days later with an objection. The recent letter that Mayor Burris sent to you all certainly does not have, as evidenced by the comments tonight, unanimous support of the town council. The charrette that I spoke of, the master plan that I spoke of, the site selection process that I spoke of, all are within the county archives. I shared the copies that I have with Commissioner Hewitt, and I'm sure he'd be willing to share those with you if you'd like to review those documents.
Time, Mr. Mattingly.
Okay, thank you. Some other comments about space needs. Recommendations are included in some of the documents that I passed out earlier in the program, and thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, Mr. Mattingly.
Thank you.
Susan Morrison. Beverly Stickles.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm Beverly Stickles, and my home address is 24825 Lucy Beale Lane, Chaptico, Maryland, and my work address is 22680 Cedar Lane Court in Leonardtown. I'm president of Cedar Lane Senior Living Community, a nonprofit senior housing community located in the town of Leonardtown, serving low and moderate income residents. Cedar Lane serves over 200 seniors with an average age of over 80. I would like to thank you, the county commissioners, for your past support of Cedar Lane and respectfully request that any future plans to move or relocate the Garvey Center take into consideration the seniors residing at Cedar Lane and consider a location that is in close proximity to our current campus. My board and I fully support partnering with you and the Area Office of Aging to avoid duplication of services and to maximize our efforts to serve the seniors of St. Mary's County. As a person who has worked in this field my entire life, I personally have witnessed the value of services such as nutrition, exercise, and socialization for seniors. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, thanks.
I think it's a Vern Lockheston.
Commissioners, my name is Vern Lockhausen. I live at 25099 Ingleside Road in Hollywood, Maryland. And I'm here representing the Tacoma Community Veterans Association. And with me is Dennis Warren, who is also a member. We both would like to speak briefly. We're here in support of the Packard River Museum, obviously. That's what two aviators would be doing up here. I represent several thousand Tacoma veterans worldwide. Tacoma is a mission that the words stand for, take charge, move out. It started at Pax River in 1964, and it is still based here with VQ Forest Detachment. Now, I started here in that mission in 1974 when the only thing that was here was the A&P market in Hewitt's Lumber and Hardware, and very few traffic signals. That was a joke. The Tacoma lab here has pioneered a number of advances in strategic nuclear command and control communications, which is what Tacoma was all about. It is local engineers and support teams have created systems such as an instrumented drogue, the thing that hangs on the end of our trailing wire antenna, that proves the stability of the very low frequency radio signal that reaches from airplanes to submerged submarines any place in the world. That system today continues to give our president and the nation assured control and contact with our strategic nuclear forces. It is a Cold War relic that continues today. During the Cold War, crews out of Pax River and other bases were airborne 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year for over 20 years. We still do exercise that tactic today at times. We in the Tacoma Community Veterans Association fully support the museum's objectives of preserving, educating, and inspiring, especially for the children and the members of our mission, the Tacoma community. We would hope that in the future, members and families of the Tacoma community could come here to Pax River as part of a vacation and visit the birthplace of this mission, see the associated artifacts that are here. I can think of no better place to do it than here and its birthplace. Our reunions, which we've had several in the last several years, are attended by several hundred people each year. In summary, Pax River is the home of our mission, and it is a place that we would like to see as a showcase in the museum here. Dennis?
Thanks. I retired last year from the Navy, flew S3s for about 10 years in the Boeing 707, the E6 Mercury jet that today performs the Tacoma mission that we just discussed. It's a big white four-engine, pretty quiet jet that we see flying around here all the time. I am a guy that loves aviation artifacts, and I'm here to tell you that Tacoma community veterans are donating their treasures and their money, and I am collecting them for our future museum home. Not just neat stuff, but to share our story with the community. There are over 100 individual items, components, photos, and artworks from that unique mission, and some of us are going in April to Arizona Aircraft Boneyard to gather some aircraft system parts to add to that collection. The Pax River Museum seems to be a perfect place for the Tacoma Heritage Center and the many local Pax River area Tacoma veterans that will be delighted to help that museum and talk it up with their friends and family. It's their life's work, and the museum will allow them to share not only with their grandchildren, but the sons and daughters of this very important mission that started many years ago. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. Dennis, is it Warren?
Yes.
That's you, okay.
Got it.
I'm sorry, I wouldn't pay attention there. Yeah. Is it Hank Caruso?
Good evening, Commissioners. Thanks for the opportunity to talk. My name is Hank Caruso. I live at 44618 Rolling Oak Lane, California, Maryland. I'm here as a life member of the Patuxent River Naval Air Museum. I'm also a volunteer. I probably spend on the average about 40 hours a week doing volunteer work, and mine isn't by far the most of some of the involvement of people. But I think it's easy to forget, because it's so close by, how unique Patuxent Naval Air Station is in the world. There is no other facility like it anywhere. The engineers, the scientists that we have here are experts. They are the world's leading experts in their subject areas. And the technology they create is the envy of every civilized nation on the planet. So the museum and the museum association were created to perpetuate, to record those stories, that information, those efforts, and to tell the stories to the public who otherwise would not have any access to them, and to tell it in a way that's understandable and entertaining. I've conducted tours for Girl Scouts, Boy Scouts, seniors, tourists, writers, high school classes. Invariably, the reaction is very enthusiastic. There are a lot of challenging questions because they're interested in what's there and they're interested in what's happened at the base here and what Patuxent Naval Air Station has contributed to the country. And they always leave enthusiastic. I can't think of any situation where that hasn't happened. Now, there's been challenges, but I would submit that overall, in spite of those challenges, the museum has been successful. We have 40,000 visitors last year, which, coming to a facility that's not on the way to a major population center or a major business center, means that they came to see the museum. So in that respect, it's already got a success story to it. We have no paid full-time staff, we have no Navy funding, yet we've been able to expand our exhibit displays and signs. We've cleaned up areas, we've remediated certain areas that were sorely in need of attention. We've expanded our programs, our interactions with the community, and with support, I think this facility, as it becomes expanded to a museum complex, I think will be outstanding in terms of a community asset, both from an education standpoint, a history standpoint, and certainly from a tourism standpoint. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Matt Morrison. There's no Matt Morrison. Justin, is that four?
Fewer, sir. Fewer. It was my intent tonight to stay with the NAACP, and thank you. I feel like we've done that adequately. Sorry about the confusion.
No problem. Thank you. Is this Martin Ahama? Did I murder your last name?
Yes, that's correct. Thank you very much. Okay. Hey, good evening. I'm here just as an ordinary citizen who wanted to express support for the Patuxent Naval Air Museum. I just wanted to offer a couple of observations on the importance of the museum to the community. I've been in the St. Mary's County, Calvert County area since 1980. I came here as an engineer working for the base. And the museum has always served as a location where I could go and really observe and appreciate the history of what's happened here at Pax River. Just recently, I was able to, I was on a trip to Taiwan, and I learned something about the importance of the Pax River area, and that I saw a book that had a history of Taiwan Air Force members who came here to be trained back in the 1960s to learn how to fly P-3s. Very interesting, because I'm in that community, and I've never heard about that incident myself and the importance of that and the effort that played during the Cold War. So there's so much history that's happened here that needs to be preserved and protected and inform the community about the importance of the base. Secondly, I think also that the base, the community itself and the museum provides an excellent venue for civic activities. Just this last weekend, I was able to participate in a fundraising event for Chesapeake Public Charter School that was held at the museum, where $9,000 was raised to support school activities. And I can only imagine that a new museum that's continued that has continued support of the county commissioners would only enhance activities like that and provide even more benefits to the community. So just as a citizen who heard about the, there was a forum here this evening to talk about, an opportunity to talk about the museum, I wanted to express a lot of support and hopefully that all the things that were said by others who are here in support of the museum is heeded by the county commissioners and that your support continues for the museum itself. Thank you very much. I didn't give my address. It's 43619 Evening Primrose Court, California, Maryland.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Scott Bruce.
Good evening. My name is Scott Bruce, 18873 McKay's Beach Road in Valley Lee. I'm here to talk to you tonight on behalf of American Helicopter Society. I'm a retired Navy test pilot, and I'm the chapter president of the local American Helicopter Society chapter, and it's 250 approximately members. A little story. In 2009, the Navy retired its last H-3 out of the entire Navy inventory. It had been flying in the Navy since 1960. At the time, we noted there was no H-3 in the museum, so it became our mission as a chapter to get an H-3 for the museum. We've been working since 2009, and over in the presidential hangar on base right now is a brand new shiny H-3. They're putting the final touches of paint on that, and it's days away from being towed out to the museum. So the American Helicopter Society is a 501c3 organization. It's an educational organization, and we believe in the mission of the museum. We use the museum, we use it for research, we use it for social events, and we put our money where our mouth is. Put it this way, we put our volunteer hours where our mouth is, and have worked hard to contribute the latest and greatest shiny new airplane for the museum, and we hope that you can do whatever you can to support the museum. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, very much.
Thank you.
Is Bob Wirt?
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Bob Wirt, executive director for the Southern Maryland Navy Alliance and chapter president for the local council of Navy League. My address is 45118 Voyage Path, California, Maryland. I'm here to voice our support for the Naval Air Museum. My wife and I first arrived here in the local area in December of 83. I flew here when A-4s, A-6s, A-7s, F-4s, and F-14s used to fly out of Pax River. All now proudly in the museum, probably where I ought to be as well. A short list of notable alumni of Pax River include astronauts Alan Shepard, Scott Carpenter, Jim Lovell, Wally Schirra, John Young, John Glenn, Pete Conrad, Alan Bean, Mark and Scott Kelly, Richard Gordon, and William McCool. Lieutenant Colleen Nevius became the first female test pilot here in 1983. Absent from this list, and those who tend not to get the recognition they deserve, are the flight test engineers, technicians, sailors and Marines, and other folks who actually make things go, or for that matter, make the call for a no-go when the risks are too high. Why do I point this out? Pensacola, Florida is referred to as the cradle of naval aviation, responsible for training the people entering that career. Pax River is also the cradle of naval aviation. Why? This is where the men and women are trained to work on test teams and where the aircraft are first tested, analyzed, fixed, and determined ready for fleet and combat use before the men and women fly them on missions wherever they are called around the world. NAS Pax River was established in 1942, 73 years ago. Lots of history. Flight test was hazardous in the early days. Today, naval aviation is outfitted with the most advanced, most effective, most deployable, safest, and most called upon combat aircraft in the world. That's because of the work done right here in St. Mary's County, done by many who were born, raised, and educated here. The heritage of Pax River cannot be overstated. It is the premier RDT&E facility in the world, second to none. And to ensure the history that got us here is never lost, and to ensure we advertise why this place is such an attraction for the younger folks here now, this museum needs your support. The Naval Air Museum will serve as an outreach to attract younger, newly educated talent to fill the needs of advancing the growing technology base here in St. Mary's County in Southern Maryland. For those who don't have access to the base, They should be afforded the insight to see what makes this place tick. It's a national asset. Just look around. The social and economic benefits of Pax River being located right here are huge. The exciting work continues on base now and into the future, developing and testing fixed and rotary wing aircraft, unmanned autonomous technologies, materials research and nanotechnology, applied physics, cyber and software development. It's unending and it's cutting edge. The Naval Air Museum will serve as a catalyst and accelerant for attracting the best and the brightest, while preserving the rich history for which we are also proud to have as a part of St. Mary's County. There's been tremendous work preserving the wonderful history of this county that dates back to the 1600s. Please support the means to preserve and display this part of the county's heritage and to ensure the future of Naval Air Museum in St. Mary's County. Let's complete the history lesson and facilitate the storytelling with the Naval Air Museum. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. That completes our sign up. Is there anyone else who would like to speak at this time? Sir, come forward.
Flight test engineer and in simulation for about 42 years, and I just recently got back in circulation, and I live at 45933 East Quincy Terrace, Lexington Park, Maryland, and I've just recently volunteered in support of the flight simulators that are over at the facility, and it's very unique in that they're all linked together. It's kind of unique compared to other facilities, and I've been participating in running the simulators, and I can tell you just in a month having been there that the children get a real benefit from it. Sometimes it's the first time they've ever seen a simulator to begin with or have a feel for what an airplane flies like. And from an educational standpoint, just from the children's standpoint, it's very beneficial. In terms of the facility itself, I worked as an engineer for 42 years, and I can tell you I was a flight test conductor for 30 of those years. And during those years, a lot of lessons were learned, and I'm still in a position to convey some of those lessons. And I can assure you there are many engineers that are around. They just don't show up. But I think as the facility becomes more and more successful, perhaps linking the simulators at the new facility outside the base would be a possibility. I was in a very early development of linking the manned flight simulator with RTPS, which is a telemetry ground system, and that worked very well. From a business standpoint, there may be possibilities to get a high fidelity simulator outside the base that could somehow link up with on the base and expand the capabilities of the facility itself and help the museum become more self-sustaining. I think the base has provided support to the community for over 50 years, I'm sure. And I, from what I've heard, that it's only asking for support until it gets its wheels underway and it gets going. And I think they really mean that, and I believe it, and I think there's real potential here. So I'm a big supporter of the simulation and of the museum and all of that. So I just wanted to convey that to you all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
What was your name, sir?
What is your first and last name?
First and last name.
William McNamara.
William McNamara.
McNamara.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak who didn't sign up? Yes, sir. Please come forward.
Didn't sign up to speak. My name is Carl Dubuck. I live at 21751 Newtown Neck Road in Compton, Maryland. They always send my mail to Leonardtown, unfortunately, but that's part of the problem of living in a little small town, or whatever they call it, of Compton, Maryland. The reason I'm up here is because I know the Navy came up, heard an Air Force guy come up here, and I also heard a couple other Navy guys come up here. I thought it ought to be a chance for a Marine to get up.
Oh.
You always tell a Marine, you just can't tell him too damn much, you know. That's part of the problem. But back in 1961, I believe it was, I came to this little community from way outside, from a place called Michigan, as a Marine officer, and I went through that school. At the time, it was only one of three test pilot schools in the free world. What a great job they've done. Now, there's a lot of, in the United States, there's only two left, by the way. Well, I should go back one step and say the three were. One was in England, one was here for the Navy, and one was out in the Air Force in Edwards. It was a fantastic ride for me going through this system. I fell in love with the county, and some after I retired from the military. I had to come here for no other reason because I loved the county. And now I'm seeing the county expand. Someone said it earlier, 235 was a dirt road back then, and I don't even think they called it 235. It was a 5 all the way, I believe. But anyway, to make a long story short, I think the museum is unique, and that is one of the few test pilot museums you'll find, or test aircraft museums you'll find anywhere in the world. And it would be a shame to see it not continue on with the great work it's doing now, bringing in an awful lot of people as simply coming here to see about it or to hear about it. And I strongly support any efforts that you gentlemen can make to make sure it continues. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else? Okay, I want to thank everyone for coming. We appreciate hearing from the general public on matters that you care about. And believe me, we listen to all this, and all five of us here, commissioners, will take your information to heart and look it over. Okay, we appreciate your input. Important part of our deliberations and decision-making. We will take this all together. We adjourn at this time.